I think a few people might be still trickling in, but we can go ahead and get started. I just want to say good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to this month's Kelsey Museum Virtual Flash Talk. Today's presentation will last about 15 minutes, followed by 15 minutes of Q&A with you, our audience. Our speaker today is James Nesbitt Prosser, a doctoral student in the Interdepartmental Program in Classical Art and Archaeology here at the University of Michigan. He earned both his BA in Classical Studies with an architecture minor in 2015 and his MA in Classical Archaeology in 2017 at Tufts University. James has taken part in the Gabi Project excavation since 2016 and began as a member of the field staff in 2018. His research interests center on late antique urbanism, Roman North Africa, and the Roman military. Today's flash talk is entitled An Example of Mobility, the Epigraphic Record of Migration from Hadrumetum to Lambaesis. I want to welcome James and go ahead and turn it over to you.
Thank you. So I'll share my screen. Now we can see the presentation. Awesome. So yeah, this is part of the beginning of my research for my dissertation, which is looking at the Roman road network and its contributions to the mobility and migration of peoples in North Africa. And specifically, this talk is adapted from the work I did this summer for an epigraphy course at the British School at Rome this past summer. So hence the emphasis on epigraphy, but it also provides kind of a good framework of research for what I'm going to be continue doing. So I would provide a little bit of a brief historiography of mobility and epigraphy and the studies of these things in North Africa. It's good to start with kind of these two really important scholars, Pierre Salama, who wrote most from the 50s into the 80s. He writes all about the Roman road system, and I'll show you guys actually the maps that he's made, which are really well done and beautiful. And he comes from this French colonial understanding of the Romans North Africa. So he really, and he saw the roads as the foundation and kind of a driving force behind the Roman colonization and the economic development of the region. He does focus very much on late antiquity, starting really in the 3rd century onward. And for studying these roads, he relies almost entirely on milestones, because there are thousands that we have records of and have been found still in the field. And he was very good in an early adapter at kind of incorporating both a wide range of archaeological and historical sources into his work. The other really major scholar is Jean-Marie Lassère, who wrote mostly in the 70s and was active even more recently. And he was a very early influence on later mobility studies. If you read anything on mobility, he's kind of one of the driving forces on modern day. He relied almost exclusively on epigraphy, and he really was a big fan of onomastics, for the study of names. So family names and tracing them as they move throughout North Africa. And his study under that's called Ubique Populus is a very important part of a really a massive wave of epigraphic studies in North Africa. And epigraphy in North Africa is in many ways its own field of study. It's the there's still journals entirely dedicated to it. So if anybody who studies epigraphy has to be well-versed in North African work. And he focuses actually on the first 3 centuries of the empire, of the imperial period. So the first 3 centuries CE. Things that are good, things have kind of changed a bit since the two of them were most active, are really even the study of roads themselves, where Ray Lawrence in 1999 really focused on not just the roads, the physical evidence of roads themselves, but really focused on how the presence and construction of roads even changed many kind of the cultural understanding of movement. So it's similar in the way we understand the development of the highway system in America in the 50s, that there became like a culture of movement along roads that wasn't there before. Think of, the freeways, how would people get around before the freeways and things like that. And he looks also at the changes in transportation methods, especially in the movement of goods. So the kind of, he focused on Italy. So the influx of the mule as the main vehicle of transporting goods and things like that. And his work, and along with, as I mentioned at the end, Horton and Purcell's work in 2000, have driven a new wave of migration mobility studies that kind of culminated most recently into an edited volume by Luke Delict and Lorenz Ernst Tacoma, Migration Mobility in the Roman Empire. And this approaches mobility and migration from many different angles, but many of them rely on epigraphic studies. And some of them, and I'll be looking at kind of similar things today, focus on the origines, or where people claim they were born or where they're from. And when I say epigraphic, I mean generally tombstones and things like that here. So I just listed kind of the more important scholars in that. And I really want to highlight Claire Halloran, because she does an excellent job in centering the movement of people based on their professions. And she looks mostly at miners and quarry people in Roman Iberia. And then especially in the Near East, Andrea Zerbini looks at a huge number of tombstones and is able to quantify movement across many sites through many centuries in the Near East, and she creates really fantastic heat maps. If you guys ever are able to look at this volume, I highly recommend it. So here we have this one of those maps of North Africa I was talking about. So here we have kind of Tunisia all the way on this end, and Algeria, modern day Algeria, is out over this way. This is not all North Africa, but this is, I wanted to focus on really these two places, Hadrumetum and Lambaesis. So you can see they're not all that close to each other, but you can see that there is quite a substantial road network. And I know there's kind of different symbols. So some of the darker, thicker red lines are really the main military trunk roads. The thinner, solid lines are slightly smaller local roads that we have a definite archaeological and evidence of, if we have our finders part of the road or like a one milestone referring to the road. And then these dotted red lines are either ones that we have some sort of loose documentary evidence, somebody mentions it, a road between two villages or something, or some of them are assumed because there are some places that we know there are small towns and things like that. We don't have the roads that connect them, but we know they must have been connected to one another. So that's how this is how we end up with this map. I think it's important we should talk about Lambaesis a little bit. So in kind of southern or middle of eastern Algeria, it was originally established as a camp for the Legio III Augusta in 81 CE. And then later on, about 40 something years later, is refounded and expanded into a permanent camp under Hadrian. And this is what the map of the kind of later permanent camp looks like. In the third century, it grew in importance and people settled around it enough that it actually became the capital of the province of Numidia, which encompassed kind of the whole area around there and all the way to the north, or to much of the north. And we see that nearby, the city of Timgad was established in 100 CE under Trajan. There was a very, very quickly a large road network, both to support the initial fortress here and the colony was built very rapidly and very well under Trajan. So in looking at this kind of mobility, I'm looking at these four extant inscriptions that are tombstones that tell us about the people who moved from Hadrumetum or claimed to be from Hadrumetum and then lived permanently in Lambaesis and actually died. And the first three, it's important to note, come from the second century. And the last one comes actually from the 3rd century. So like I said, this is from an epigraphy course, so I had to include the inscriptions in them. These are, we don't actually have any of, we don't have any images of these inscriptions themselves. And they're kind of listed as in a wall in a house in the alley of this town and things like that. So it's part of one project I have in mind for the future, is to try and actually see these things if they still exist. But they were around in the late 1800s, and that's how we have these examples in the corpus inscriptionum latinarum. So this is about from Blasius Saturnina. You can see this horum here that actually stands for Hadrumetum. And she lived and died there, was put up by her sons. Next, we have a Publius Afranius, similarly, a different symbol, a different word, but still this word means that saying he's from Hadrumetum. You can actually see it nicely put down here. And this next one's really interesting. This is Julia Secunda. And she, again, this H-A-D-R from Hadrumetum. And what's really interesting is this symbol here means centurion. So she is the wife of a centurion in the fort at Lambaesis. So we don't usually know of too many soldiers who are married. So this, they probably got married after he was discharged or something like that. But he's saying, you know, for the best wife and things like that. And then this is the one from the 4th century. This is Lucius Aelius Macer. And here we have Hadrumento fully written out. So it's, and again, this is put up by his wife. So one thing I want to try and look at and understand are the ways that people move through the landscape. And if we're looking based purely on efficiency of how of people move through the landscape, there's kind of two possible routes that would be the easiest. The first one would involve first going by sea. So Hadrumetum is on the coast. So taking a boat up to around the coast of Tunisia to northern Algeria, then down the Rusakad, Kirta, then Timgad, and then Lambaesis is just an offshoot off of Timgad. Or the other would be going directly over land, which would be Hadrumetum to Sufetla, the Vests, Timgad, Lambaesis. So generally steadily west from Hadrumetum. So one thing that we're always kind of taught in the movement in the ancient world is that the sea route is always faster. And that is technically true here. It is faster, I think, according to Orbis, which should not be the the be all end all. It's about 2 days faster to go by sea. And technically, the way we understand that, it's technically cheaper. However, that has to do with more the movement of goods than actual people going themselves. And what's interesting is we look at the actual patterns of movements using the similar methodology of looking at tombstones from the places. We only really see one possible example of people moving north to south from Rusakad or Kirta down towards Lambaesis and Timgad. However, if you look at the east-west movement over land, we have many other examples of people moving east-west. So it seems that for whatever reason, people were choosing the overland route as opposed to the sea route. So if we're looking at the, you know, if overland is happening much more, they kind of have to make use of this road network. It's well-maintained. It's pretty brand spanking new around the time that Lambaesis is really growing quite quickly in the 2nd century. So, and we have from around Hadrumetum itself, we don't know exactly where, we have 3 milestones that talk about repairs of Antoninus Pius. The road was already there and it was repaired under him in the mid to late 2nd century. Between the Vest and Timgad, we have one milestone that talks about the construction of this road under Trajan. So that's the example I put up here. And then we see that in the 3rd and 4th centuries, we have oodles of repairs, 9 mentioning it, 23 from the 4th century. And that's a whole thing about in the 3rd and 4th century, an easy way to establish legitimacy, especially if you're not so secure in your rule of the area, is to repair the roads and tell everybody that you repaired the roads. And we see a similar pattern between Tim Gettle and Lambaesis is kind of the shortest part of our of the journey. But we have one from Trajan talking about the building of this road. And then again, 9 from the 3rd and 5 from the 4th century. So kind of some quick conclusions this is that I've come to about this. That seems that the construction of the road really under Trajan and the fact that Lambaesis is a bit of a boom town from this time period, especially under Hadrian, when it's refounded, and that involves a lot of investment, a lot of people needed for construction and maintenance and things like that. It seems that these factors drove a massive wave of migration coming overland from the east. And the fact that the new Imperial Trunk Road, you know, brand spanking new highway along most of the route really seems to many people have reduced the quote unquote time space for travel and kind of the, you know, if there's no road, it's harder to go over land. But if you have a road there, it does in ways create a culture of people moving. It's unknown why these people move. They none of them mention their professions. It's typically wives, except for the one who is married to a centurion. So that's the only one associated directly with the military. And as we know, and as I've talked about, Lambaesis was primarily a military fort. So it's interesting that of the four examples, only one is related to the military. And if we look at not just ones from Hadrumento, if we look at other tombstones from Lambaesis, you'll see that there is a shocking lack of people really mentioning the military, as you would expect. And that is, and then, oh yes, my ideas for kind of future work looking at this, I want to look at this pattern, compare it, and try and figure out the streams of migration going out throughout North Africa, not just along this path, but to see if there's, you know, other east-west patterns, north-south patterns anywhere else. So this was kind of just a first foray into that. And then one thing I was kind of running into is that Salama talks about the 3rd century onward, kind of to the 5th, 6th century. And Lassère really only focuses on the 1st to 3rd. So trying to find as much overlap and really try and bridge the work that they do, because I really did well to set the foundations for this kind of study. And then this is my bibliography. So that is all I have. So thank you all.
Thank you so much, James. That was incredibly interesting. I want to open up this opportunity to the audience for questions. So go ahead and unmute yourselves and you can ask your question. And you can also put it in the chat as well, and then I will read it out. But we can go ahead and get started. I saw a few hands. But let's start maybe with Sam Joseph Ross. You want to go first?
Sure. Thank you for the talk, James. So we have these four kind of tombstones, as well as like a clearly documented kind of infrastructural emphasis on the road. Do you see these four inscriptions as part of a broader pattern of movement between other cities along using these roads, or is the evidence mostly for Lambaesis and Hadrumetum? And also, is the movement always towards Lambaesis, or do we see kind of this broader kind of pattern of mobility utilizing these road networks?
Yeah, no, so thank you for that. We definitely see, there are definitely more patterns. This was just kind of the first one I looked at, but we see also a lot of movement to Timgad, which is the colony that was originally meant for the veterans of Lambaesis nearby. We see a large number of people moving from Thavest, and we see a significant number of people even moving from the coasts inland. So that would require quite a bit of, that would require the roads. And North Africa, the reason why roads are fascinating in North Africa for me more than most other places is that there truly is a lack of navigable rivers in the region. So when people would say, oh, why would they use roads if there's a river nearby? There weren't really any rivers. So it's the importance of roads is kind of emphasized here. And yeah, it's fascinating that we see really the east-west movement, more inland and from the coast, as opposed to what we would expect to see more from the modern world, almost, of people moving to the coastal regions.
Thank you. Okay, next question. Go ahead, Ginny.
Hi, James. So I have a bit of a theory question, I guess, and it might be a little bit outside the scope of your presentation, but I guess I was wondering how you are understanding the difference between mobility and migration, if you're seeing a difference there. And I think you also mentioned from the tombstones that they were it was people who moved permanently. Mm-hmm. And if there's any way, if you have any sort of evidence for maybe less permanent kind of mobility, mm-hmm. right? Like a more temporary mobility between the two sites.
Unfortunately, we don't have too much in terms of understanding people moving back. We don't have like we have in Italy, where there's people talking about seasonal work, like those who come to Rome, they go back to other places. But I think there are there are other places that talk about professions. So I think we know between Kirta and Rusicata, we have reference to like tree carriers and things like that. So we know that because Rusicata is the port related to Kirta nearby. We know that there's movement back and forth between those two. I don't think we know anything specific of, you know, the one thing example I could think of would be if we could find cattle drovers or something like that, or grain, you know, merchants or things like that. But I don't think we have any specific things of that. And I mentioned permanent here because it's clear that the people who were buried here, these were tombstones set up by the husbands or children and things like that. So I'm assuming that where they put their families, where they moved to permanently. But they're just saying, I was born in Hadrumetum and then I moved here.
Great, thank you. Okay, our next question from Anne Cassidy.
Yes, I just wondered if there was a coordination between road building and availability of water sources.
Mm. So yeah, we know from a lot of, we have a lot of road stations, kind of like stopping points along the roads, that a lot of them are associated with wells and things like that, because if you're using animals like donkeys and mules and things like to move goods around, you actually have to soak their feet every once in a while. So there need to be places nearby the roads that have access to water. It's not quite clear that the roads will be falling along the side of rivers or things like that, because there really weren't that many, or the water was quite seasonal. It's easy to suspect that wells were dug nearby to, you know, make it possible to inhabit or move along these roads.
Great, thank you. Does anyone else have any more questions? Linda, go ahead.
This isn't exactly on point, but if we've got a moment, how does this protocol that you've been using and the findings that you've come up with so far play out when taken away from the Roman context? Is this all pretty specific to the Roman Empire, or could you do the same sort of exploration in India, for example?
It definitely could work in other contexts. I think what works well for this period, especially looking at Roman Empire, is this kind of overarching political structure. Because one thing that we've kind of come to recognize for travel along roads is the idea of political stability. So I think as long as there's a place where there's an overarching understanding of political stability, not only able to build the roads, but maintain them and maintaining this sense of safety along them, you will generally see people moving along them, whether permanently or temporarily. And I mean, that's not to say that safety is required for people to move through a landscape generally, but for the kind of the use of a road and sustained enough travel to a place, it works well to understand it. It works well under the Roman Empire, as opposed to, I mean, there's several empires in India that I think the Mauryan Empire also built roads and things like that. That's just, I know nothing about the Mauryan Empire, but that's my guess. It would work well there as long as we are able to have people claiming on, you know, in their own self-identification of being from someplace else, it would work well.
This all just seems opens up, as you were saying, this rather fascinating vista of the culture of being able to move fairly routinely, mm-hmm. at a relative low personal risk, as opposed to migrations that are fostered for reasons of fleeing, for mm-hmm. example.
Yeah, it's fascinating because if we see the movement of people as more for, you know, more personal economic gain than as like, oh, we're like fleeing the Huns across the Danube and things like that. It's a bit of a different kind of migration. We could think of it almost like somebody emigrating from New York to LA for a job or something like that.
Right. Yeah. As opposed to a family member going out and exploring, or a community member going out and exploring and then coming back and bringing some other people back with them, but it being a major life-changing event that you might only do once.
Yeah, it's definitely possible.
Yeah. Okay, thanks.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Linda. Let's move on to Stephen. You can go ahead and ask your question.
Thanks. I just actually wanted to say two things. First off, that was really interesting. I really enjoyed it. Thank you so much. Second of all, I wanted to follow up on what Linda said about the difference between maybe migration and other forms of movement. I'm using the same process that you are to trace survivors from the eruption of Vesuvius out of Pompeii to other places. And it works. And it's a different type of movement. You know, there mm-hmm. are people that can't go back, obviously. Mm-hmm. But your emphasis on the roads has given me something to think about here. And I think that's really intriguing. I did have actually one question on your work. I noticed you're using CIL for mm-hmm. your inscriptions. And I wondered if there might be other sources or databases. You know, CIL doesn't always publish graffiti, for example. Mm-hmm. And I wondered if maybe those same names might appear in other collections of graffiti, which might give you more of an insight into, so for example, professions. I've had some success with that. So I just wanted to suggest it as a possible. If you need something else to do, there you go.
Yeah, no, no, thank you for that suggestion. That's certainly possible. I know, CIL has its issues, especially. I mean, all these inscriptions come from the initial publication of CIL 8 in 1890 something. So it hasn't been updated all that much, but luckily, graffiti is always difficult, especially in North Africa. I don't think too much of it has been published from there, but the thing with the epigraphy in North Africa has been poured over for 150 years. So luckily I feel all right using uh-huh. it. But I'll definitely take a look and see if I can find any graffiti from Lambaesis or Timgad or someplace like that. Thank you.
Great. Thanks.
Thank you. Does anyone else have any questions? Okay, well, I think we might wrap up here. I want to thank James for a fascinating talk today. And I want to thank you, our audience, for joining us today and for your support of the Kelsey Museum. And check our website for our further flash talks. Thank you so much, everyone, and have a good weekend.
Thank you all.